morning, Noose Baptist. How y'all doing this morning? It's good to see you. Let's stand and sing, "On Christ the solid rock I stand. All other ground is sinking sand." Sing with me this morning.
Thank you so much for being here this morning at Noose Baptist Church for our Sunday morning service. Last week we were able to celebrate Easter, and the good news is Jesus is still alive. Amen. He's still on the throne. Nothing's changed. And I'm so glad you're here this morning. I'm looking forward to what God has for us. Let's bow our heads and pray. Ask God to bless our services this morning. Father, we do thank you for the eternal truth that you are alive forevermore. Yes. God, we thank you you're on the throne this morning. We thank you for the privilege and opportunity we have to be in your house. Lord, and so many things are going on in our world and in our lives, we ask that at this moment you would quiet our hearts, quiet our minds. Lord, help us to focus in on you. Today, may we worship you in spirit and in truth. May we be in tune with what you have for us this morning. Lord, may you be high, holy, and lifted up in everything that's said and done, from the singing to the reading of your word and the preaching of it. God, may you be glorified. And we have a proper vision of you this morning. And Lord, may we worship you and see you only. Bless us now. In Christ we do pray. Amen. Amen. If you're able, remain standing as we sing, "I Know Whom I Have Believed."
We know that he is able to keep that which he's delivered unto him against that day. We are glad to sing, "I Know Whom I Have Believed."
Never swim.
seated. Listen as the choir sings, "We Preach Christ." Let's stand and sing, "Faith is the victory that overcomes the world." Faith is the victory.
be seated. It's awfully good to have Meredith and Paul back with us, and we enjoy them and their part in our ministry. Listen as Meredith comes to sing for us.
If you would, take your Bible this morning and turn with me to the Old Testament book of Jonah. Jonah chapter 1, please. I appreciate that song very much. Thank you, Meredith. Thank you for the cross. Jonah chapter 1. We are going to introduce a couple of series today that are going to be starting. One this morning in the book of Jonah. the next few Sunday mornings, more than a few, we're going to be looking at the book of Jonah, and then on Sunday nights, we're going to be looking at the book of Colossians. And so I hope you'll be here for that, and as we work our way through God's Word, you know, you always find, when you look at the context of Scripture, answers to your everyday life. And the Bible is sufficient in every part. And that's when we take these times to go line by line and to learn from God's Word. But specifically this morning, we're going to be looking at the book of Jonah, introducing this book. It's probably the most well-known of all the minor prophets. It's probably one of the earliest stories you learned if you grew up in church, in children's church, about Jonah and the whale. And it's really an incredible book that speaks to us today. I'm not preaching this because of the events tomorrow, but I had a long time ago thought about preaching through this book. But for a lot of people, especially those theologians today, they look at Jonah as not a historical book, not one of that's historically accurate, but they look at it more as allegory or maybe even romance in its place in biblical literature. And the question comes to mind, you know, was Jonah a real person? Did a real great fish swallow Jonah and spit him back up? Did Nineveh really repent at the preaching of Jonah? Is this book true? Is it historical? Is it fact or is it not? And the answer that you have to that question, it matters much more than you think. And we'll see a little bit about that as we, I think, prove some of these things to be true. But as we introduce this book, I want to set a few things straight, just three questions off the top about this book of Jonah. The first thing is Jonah himself a historical character? Is he a historical figure that we see here in this book and then also throughout Scripture? Well, again, I want you to notice verse number 1 of Jonah. It says, "Now the word of the Lord came unto Jonah, the son of Amittai." We see in verse number 1 that the word of God came, meaning that Jonah was a prophet. He had special revelation from God that came to him. He was the mouthpiece for God, for the people of Israel. It says here he's also the son of Amittai. Now, do we see Jonah anywhere else in the Bible? The answer to that is yes. If you would quickly turn back to 2 Kings chapter 14. 2 Kings chapter 14. Leave your place in the book of Jonah. We're going to be back here in just a little bit. But 2 Kings chapter 14. And notice with me verse number 23. 2 Kings chapter 14, verse 23. It says, "In the 15th year of Amaziah, the son of Joash, king of Judah, Jeroboam, the son of Joash, king of Israel, began to reign in Samaria, and reigned 41 years." Now, I want you to remember that name in verse 23, Jeroboam, and the fact that he reigned 41 years. Verse 24, "And he," that is Jeroboam, "did that which was evil in the sight of the Lord, and he departed not from all the sins of Jeroboam, the son of Nebat, who made Israel to sin." Verse 25, "He restored the coast of Israel from the entering of Hamath unto the sea of the plain, according to the word of the Lord God of Israel, which he spake by the hand of his servant Jonah, the son of Amittai, the prophet, which was of Gath Hepher." So we see here in 2 Kings chapter 14, this king is introduced to us. This is Jeroboam the second. One of the kings of Israel, and he reigned 41 years. He had a very successful reign as far as politically and militarily. He did a good job there. You see in verse 25 that he restored the coast of Israel. He actually expanded the borders of Israel during his reign. So he had a pretty profitable reign, but you'll also notice in verse 24 that he did that which was evil in the sight of the Lord. And that's important because that phrase plays into this book of Jonah. The fact that Jeroboam II, who was the king when Jonah was the prophet, did evil in the sight of God, plays into really the reason that Jonah made the decision that he did. As you know the story, we'll get to it. I'm trying not to get ahead of myself. I want to. I'm trying to slow myself down and get through it. But we see here in 2 Kings 14 that this reference is proof that Jonah was a real historical character. Just as Jeroboam II was a real historical king, so was Jonah a real prophet. So that's the first question. Was Jonah a historical figure? Absolutely, he was. And the second question, is the book of Jonah historical? We know Jonah himself to be a historical figure, but is this book itself historical, or is it just a allegory or romance as we get into it? One of the reasons that people believe that is because the heavy presence of the supernatural in the book of Jonah. Obviously, we all know that the great fish swallowed Jonah, right? That's like the whole focus of this story for us. And that's pretty supernatural that this would happen. But as we look at this account, we have to understand that that just because there is supernatural does not mean it's not historical. I don't know about you, but my God can do anything. Amen. And if my God can do anything, then he will do anything. And as we look at this book, we need to see that the supernatural, all-powerful God can use whatever means necessary to bring about his will. I mean, the same God who created or used this great fish is the same God who used a donkey to talk, and he caused fire to come down from heaven, and he did all kinds of miracles. And so what we see is that God can use the supernatural as he does in this book. But also, Jesus himself referenced Jonah and this story. In Matthew chapter 12, verse 39 through 41, it says, this is Jesus, but he answered and said unto them, an evil and adulterous generation seeketh after a sign, and there shall no sign be given to it, but the sign of the prophet Jonas, or Jonah. For as Jonah was 3 days and 3 nights in the whale's belly, so shall the Son of Man be 3 days and 3 nights in the heart of the earth. The men of Nineveh shall rise in judgment with this generation, and shall condemn it, because they repented at the preaching of Jonah, and behold, a greater than Jonah is here. The Gospel of Luke also records the same reference that Christ made to Jonah, which tells us that this is a historical fact, because why would Jesus reference a fictional story to speak to his real resurrection from the dead? He wouldn't. He would have used real historical fact as a picture of his real historical resurrection. And so, folks, if we look at the book of Jonah and say, I don't think this is a real story, then we're missing the fact that Jesus himself referenced this book and used it as historical fact. Jesus believed this was God's word, this was true, this was historical, and it took place, and we should as well. Now, I want to answer one more question as we kind of think about this book. What about the great fish? What about this great fish that swallowed up Jonah? Could it happen? The answer is yes. Again, my God's big enough to do anything that he pleases. He can split a sea in two. He can cause a lion not to eat a man in a pit. And he can certainly use a great fish to swallow a man. The other question is, did it happen? Again, I would say yes. In J. Sidlow Baxter's book, Explore the Book, he tells of an account of a man named Sir Francis Fox who was swallowed by a whale in 1891. There's other accounts he tells of that as well. If that's not sufficient for you, a quick Google search will show you that on June 11th, 2021, there was a man by the name of Michael Packard who was a lobster diver who was swallowed and spit out by a whale in 2021. So this has just happened not that long ago. So what do we see when we look at history, when we look at these questions? Yes, Jonah is a real historical figure. Yes, Jonah, the book of Jonah, is a real historical account. And yes, a great fish could swallow a man and spit him out. So all of the book of Jonah is true. But let me just kind of end it like this. God said it, and that settles it. Amen. It's in God's word. It doesn't matter if you believe it or not. It's there. We believe it. It's true. Amen. God's word settles it. So with all that, let's stand together. Look in Jonah chapter 1. We're going to get to our text this morning, the first three verses. That sermon was free. Jonah chapter 1, starting in verse number 1 again, says, now the word of the Lord came unto Jonah, the son of Amittai, saying, arise, go to Nineveh, that great city, and cry against it, for their wickedness is come up before me. But Jonah rose up to flee unto Tarshish from the presence of the Lord, and went down to Joppa, and he found a ship going to Tarshish. So he paid the fare thereof and went down into it to go with them unto Tarshish from the presence of the Lord. I want you to notice that first phrase in verse number 3, and it says, but Jonah rose up to flee, and then it says, from the presence of the Lord. Jonah rose up to flee from the presence of the Lord. Now again, we saw in verse 1 that the word of the Lord came to Jonah, which means he is a prophet. Jonah is the man of God. He knows God. He knows God's word. He's communicated with God before. And he knows, Jonah is no fool. He knows he cannot escape the presence of God. But yet it says in verse number 3 that Jonah rose up to flee from the presence of the Lord. So what does that mean that he was trying to get from the presence of the Lord? Well, often that term, presence of the Lord, can refer to the place of worship. It's where the word of God is heard, where prayers are spoken. It's where the Lord is served. So when Jonah rose up to flee from the presence of the Lord, he knew he couldn't escape God for who he was, but Jonah was giving up on his prophetic call. He was giving up on everything in his life that God had led him to. He was saying, Lord, I'm not doing it. Lord, I'm not going to do what you're telling me to do. And Jonah was willing to give up on everything because he didn't want to go to Nineveh. He didn't want to see those people repent. He had no desire. And so what did Jonah do? He tried to give up on God. Jonah tried to give up on God. And I wonder today, how many of us here are trying to flee from the presence of the Lord? We know that God's big enough we can never actually get away from his presence. But maybe there's someone here who's right on the edge of giving up on God. Right on the edge of just giving up on this whole Christianity thing. Right on the edge of giving up on being a member of this church or being faithful to God's house, being in his word. Right on the edge of giving up on everything that God has called us to. And we hear that still small voice speaking to us. But today, we're walking the docks of Joppa, trying to find us a ship to flee from the presence of the Lord. And by God's help this morning, I want to preach on that title, Giving Up on God. Giving Up on God. Let's bow our heads for prayer. Father, I thank you for this day. And Lord, I thank you for your word. God, I thank you for the fact that we can trust it. It is true, it is from you, and it is settled in heaven, and it's settled in our hearts. Lord, I ask you to help us today as we look at this great example we have in Jonah. Lord, help us to learn from it. Help me as I preach this morning. Lord, cleanse me of sin, empty me of myself, and fill me with your spirit. God, be with your people this morning. Lord, I ask you to help them as you speak to their hearts, God, that they will do business with you. Lord, if there's someone here today under the sound of my voice who does not know you as their personal Savior, may today be the day of salvation for them. Well, thank you. In Christ's name, do pray. Amen. Thank you. You may be seated. Again, as we think about this truth and this instance that we see here of Jonah trying to give up on God, I want you to notice just a couple things with me, two things this morning, steps that really led to this decision that Jonah made. The first thing we see as we look at this passage of Scripture this morning is we see God's assignment. God's assignment. You know, we typically think of God's assignment as something that he gives to preachers and missionaries, something that he's designed just for them. But the truth is, God has an assignment for every one of us. Everyone who is a born-again believer has an assignment from God, a purpose and a plan from him for them to fulfill in his will. There's an assignment that's given from God, and specifically for Jonah, there was an assignment that was given from God. Jonah had a specific ministry. God had a specific plan that he wanted Jonah to fulfill. I want you to notice the first thing we see in God's assignment is the people. The people. Notice again verse number 1. It says, now the word of the Lord came unto Jonah, the son of Amittai, saying, arise, go to Nineveh, that great city. Arise, go to Nineveh, that great city. Nineveh was one of the capital cities of the Assyrian Empire. Nineveh and the Assyrian Empire were really known as a very brutal people. If a city knew that they were going to be coming under attack or they were going to be defeated by the Assyrians, many times they would commit suicide just to avoid being taken captive by the Assyrians. They were known for their horribly brutal and torturing practices. And I won't go all into it, but cutting off hands and feet, being skinned alive, pulling out people's tongues, and many other horrible, horrible things that the Assyrians did to their captives. And the Assyrians were a feared people. And the people of Nineveh would have fallen in line with that. They were a feared people because they were so brutal. And Jonah, the prophet, again, he was reigning at the time of Jeroboam II. And if you remember back in 2 Kings 14:24, It says that while Jeroboam II was reigning, what did he do? He did evil in the sight of the Lord. In other words, Jeroboam was not obeying God. And if you know your Bible history, you see in the book of Judges and what happens in Kings is that when the people of Israel strayed away from God, God would send them into captivity. He would use other people to judge them. Because that's true, because Jonah is a prophet, he's the man of God, he knows that Jeroboam II is going to bring judgment on his people. That God's people can't keep sinning and get away with it, that God is going to use somebody to get their attention, and Jonah knows very well the people of Assyria are most likely the ones that God's going to use to judge his people. And as Jonah understands that, he again knows what these people are like. He knew these Assyrian people. He knew the people of Nineveh, and he knew that God would use them to execute his wrath on his people. But notice again what the assignment was, the people that God was sending Jonah to. Now the word of the Lord came unto Jonah, the son of Amittai, saying, "Arise, go to Nineveh." The people that God was sending Jonah to were the Ninevites. He wasn't sending them to anybody else. God specifically said to Jonah, "I want you to arise, get up, and go to the people of Nineveh." That was the assignment that God had given to him. God was asking Jonah to go to a people group that Jonah considered to be the enemy. Someone that no Jewish person would have wanted to go to. No one who would have wanted to be a part or go to anywhere close to the people of Nineveh. But that was the people that God was sending Jonah to. Not only do we see the people that he sends them to, but also we see the purpose in God's assignment. Notice again verse 2. He says, "Arise, go to Nineveh, that great city," and notice, "and cry against it, for their wickedness is come up before me." God's assignment was that Jonah would go to the people of Nineveh, and his purpose in sending Jonah was that he would preach a coming judgment of God to that people. Right. Now, Jonah would have probably liked the idea of preaching judgment to these people, but he wouldn't have liked the idea of those people repenting. Just quickly, look at chapter 4 of Jonah. Chapter 4, look at verse number 2. This is really the answer to why Jonah does what he does. Jonah chapter 4, verse 2, and it says, "And he prayed unto the Lord and said, I pray thee, O Lord, was not this my saying when I was yet in my country? Therefore I fled before unto Tarshish, for I knew thou art a gracious God and merciful, slow to anger and of great kindness, and repentest thee of the evil." You want to know why Jonah does what he does? Because he knew who his God was. You see, the people that God was sending Jonah to, the assignment that he had was that he would go to the people of Nineveh, that he would cry against them and tell them, listen, there is a judgment that is coming unless you repent. But Jonah did not want to go to these people because he knew how long-suffering and merciful his God was. You know, usually when we talk about the long-suffering of the Lord, we say amen. We enjoy that. We enjoy God's long-suffering as long as it applies to us. But when God's long-suffering applies to someone else that we don't like, we're not a big fan anymore. And we like to think as we sit here in church on Sunday morning, as we think that we're pretty good people, but could it be that there's some people in this world that, you know what, we don't really know if we want them to be saved? You say, Pastor, we would never say that. I know we wouldn't say it, but in our hearts it's true. You think Jonah would ever said, I don't want the Assyrians to come to the Lord? He's a prophet. He can't say that. But in his heart, his actions spoke directly to that. The assignment that God had given was that he would go and that he would preach to these people. And what we think often when we think about Jonah is that we think he quit on God, or that he didn't do what God told him to do because he was some kind of coward. Because he just backed down, because he was just too afraid to do what God had called him to do. That's not it at all. What Jonah did is that he was so opposed to going to the Ninevites, to seeing them repent, he was such a bold patriot for his people that he was willing to quit on his prophetic role and run for God just so they wouldn't repent. Jonah's not a coward. Jonah's a patriot. Jonah's not a coward. He's stubborn. And he wants nothing to do with God's, with these people that God is calling him to. He wants nothing to do with his enemy. In his heart, he didn't want those people to repent. But here's the truth. Jonah didn't see people how God saw people. You know what God wanted? He wanted the wicked, sinful, dirty, rotten people of Nineveh to repent and experience his grace. And Jonah didn't want that to happen. You know what the truth is today? God still wants people all over this world, dirty, rotten, stinking people, to experience his grace. Amen. And guess what? That's where you and I were, but for his grace. Right. That's where we were. We were those ones that no one wanted to come to. That was us, folks. And could it be that God in his sovereignty had a better plan for Jonah than Jonah had for Jonah? Could it be that God knew better? That God knew what he was doing? And yet Jonah was willing to lay himself down, get as far away as possible from the presence of God because he didn't want to do what God had told him to do. He wanted nothing to do with the people of Nineveh. He didn't want any of that. He didn't want to be any part of God's purpose. He didn't want to serve the Lord anymore. You know, I still feel pretty young. 27, I'm young. It wasn't that long ago that I was in Bible college. And Bible college is the place generally you go to prepare for ministry. I mean, you're usually there with people that are preparing for ministry. You know, I could tell you people today that I went to school with not that many years ago that are not serving God anymore. I mean, I don't just mean like they're not in ministry, but they're not even in like church anymore. Like they have nothing to do with God anymore. And I have people that I went to high school with, went to youth group with, went to Christian school with, that are not even close to God anymore. Right. I know some that are dead. I'm young. What is it? It's that God has a purpose, and we don't want to be a part of God's purpose. And so what do? We give up on God. We turn away and we run. Because we don't want anything to do with what God has called us to, what God has assigned us to do. And people I know, and but for God's grace, I'm there, have given up on God because they don't like the assignment and the purpose that God has given to them. But listen, folks, again, just before we give Jonah a hard time, can we put ourselves in his place? Can we take a look at ourselves? How many times has God given us an assignment and a purpose to do that we want nothing to do with? A place he's called us to that we don't want to serve there. Listen, we have an assignment from God. He has a purpose for you. But are we willing to be a part of it? Listen, Dad, God has called you to be the spiritual leader in your home. And in America in 2024, we need men that will lead in the home. Not just put a casual face on at church and be something totally different at the house. We need you to be a genuine Christian in your home, Dad. That's the assignment God's given to you.
Amen.
Mom, he's called you to be that heart of the home.
Yes.
To be the one that loves and protects and serves and submits to the husband as he leads and loves the Lord. Sir, God's called you to love your wife. Again, we need men that will love their wives, that will lead in that way. Ma'am, he's called you to submit to your husband. As he loves you, you submit to him.
Amen.
Listen, God has a purpose in all of this. But we like to look at everybody. They're not doing their role. They're not doing their job, so I'm not going to do mine. God has a purpose and an assignment for you that he's called you to do. Don't quit on him because of it.
Amen.
Don't back out. Listen, young person, college and career age student, God has called you to be a light and a witness where you are.
Amen.
This is a time in your life when you can serve God with all of your heart. You should anyway, but serve God with all that you have because you don't have the things that you will have later on in life. He's called you to be here at this place, to serve him here at this church. Teenager, God has called you, young person, God has called you to be obedient, to honor your parents. It's still there in the Bible. And you're still there to listen and to obey it. Church member, God has called you to serve him here. Be faithful to the meetings that we assemble together here at God's house. Employee, he still called you to have the right attitude in your workplace, to be the light that he's called you to be there, even if your boss is a jerk. Listen, folks, I'm just trying to be real this morning. God has an assignment for you. He has a purpose and he has a plan for you. But are you quitting on God because of that? Jonah heard the assignment of God and he quit on God because of it. God is calling us to something this morning, church. He's calling us to be a part of something. You know, we get so tired of doing the day in and day outs of life. You know, we have a schedule. You have a schedule with something you're going to do this week, Monday through Friday. The day in and day out of life. But guess what? That's the people that God has assigned you to. Those that you see on a daily basis. And there's a purpose in that assignment. And can I just tell you that not every day is an extraordinary day, but every day is an important day. And it's the days that seem very monotonous and you do it over and over and over again that make you who you are for those extraordinary days. And if we're not going to serve God on the ordinary days, we won't serve God on the extraordinary days. If we won't be a part of God's assignment and be part of his purpose on the ordinary days, we won't be on the extraordinary days. God is calling us to his purpose, to the people that we're with. But are we committed to that assignment that he's given to us? And can I just encourage you this morning to not give up on God. Don't quit on him because he has something that he wants you to do uniquely. He wants to use you uniquely in your assignment that he has for you. But listen, if you quit on God now, you'll never get to look back and say, man, I see what God did there. I see how God used me there. I see what God did behind the scenes and how he brought all that to light. There's an assignment this morning. Church, are we willing to be a part of it? When we see this man, Jonah, we see that he was certainly not serving the Lord with gladness, right? One of our themes for this year is to serve the Lord with gladness. In other words, serve the Lord in your assignment with gladness. Jonah wasn't doing that. Church, are you open and available to God's assignment for you today? Or are you on the edge of giving up on God? And when I say giving up on God, I don't mean you're going to drop out of church and never come back. That may be true. But giving up on God is in you're here, but you're not really here. Physically, you may be here, but your heart's not here. You may not be close to God anymore. You may have stopped trying. You may have quit and given up on the inside. You have a form of godliness, but no power thereof. There's an assignment from God. Are you open to that assignment, or are you giving up on God? First, we see God's assignment. I want you to notice, secondly and finally, we see Jonah's abandonment. Jonah's abandonment. Again, when Jonah heard God's assignment, he was one to let everything else supersede his desire to serve the Lord and be obedient to him. Notice in verse number 3, we see his decision. Look at verse number 2 just to keep the flow. Arise, go to Nineveh, that great city, and cry against it, for their wickedness has come up before me. But Jonah rose up to flee unto Tarshish from the presence of the Lord, went down to Joppa, and he found a ship going to Tarshish. What do we see here? That as soon as Jonah heard what God's assignment was, he made his decision, and he was getting out of Dodge. He was not going to be anywhere close to what God was wanting him to do. And I think really he gave up on God's assignment. He made this decision for two reasons. First, because the job was hard. As we'll see, the trip to Nineveh was many miles. It would take a long way to get there. It was a long journey. And if Jonah got there, at best, he'd be mocked, made fun of, treated poorly. At best, at worst, he'd be tortured. Again, remember some of the torture that people went through, tortured and killed. So the assignment that God had given to Jonah was not an easy one. And can I just say that God's assignments aren't always easy? That often it's very hard to serve the Lord. It can be very difficult. We can make some sacrifices to serve the Lord. But I can tell you, and Jonah is proof, that it's always better to pay the price to the Lord than it is to pay the price to get back to the Lord. Pay up front and let the Lord use you. It's rarely easy to obey God, and taking the high road will cost you. We see first reason he said no because the job was hard, but I think the second reason Jonah decides to really abandon God's call is because he didn't want the Assyrians in Nineveh to escape God's judgment. He didn't want them to repent. We saw back in 2 Kings chapter 14 and verse 25 that Jonah was from a place called Gath Hepher. That was in the tribe of Zebulun towards the northern part of Israel. If you look at a map of the Assyrian Empire, it was very vast and actually kind of wraps around to the top of Judah and where people of Israel, the northern part of Israel, would have been. I don't know this for sure, but it is possible that Jonah had known or had experienced some of the attacks of the Assyrian people. It could be that he personally had dealt with being hurt by the Assyrians, maybe by the people of Nineveh, that he had experienced some kind of pain because of them. And in order for him to go to these people, Jonah knew he'd have to forgive these people first. And that's always very hard to do. It's always hardest to forgive those that have hurt you personally, those that have done something to you personally. But even if that's not true, Jonah knew of a certainty that the Assyrians were a real threat to his own people. Again, he knew that they were in sin, that God would use a people to get them straightened up, the people of Israel to straighten them up. And really, he didn't want the Assyrians to receive God's mercy. Look again at verse number 3. It says, "But Jonah rose up to flee unto Tarshish." He made that decision because he didn't want this great wicked people to repent. He wanted them to experience God's judgment. And the truth is, again, though we give Jonah a hard time for his decision that he made, it's often like us. We don't want to arise and go. We like it where we are. It's comfortable here. But we don't want to go to that neglected people. We don't want to go to the ones that are wicked. We don't want to go to those brutal ones and those sinful people. And could it be, folks, as we think about ourselves truthfully, could it be that we're a lot like Jonah? Could it be that there's some people that we just don't love enough to go to? That we're not concerned enough to be a witness to? And we look at Jonah and say, "Jonah, how could you make such a foolish decision? You have no idea what's coming for you." But could it be that we've also gone with Jonah to Joppa? That we've also abandoned God's assignment for us? We've made a decision to get up and try to flee from his presence, even though we can never actually do that. And the reason we've done that is because we don't have God's compassion. We don't see people like God sees people. We don't see this world like God sees people. You know really what the book of Jonah is? It's an example of God's extreme mercy. It's an example of what God is willing to do to reach lost people. It's a book of missions is what it is. How God will use us to reach people, even people that we consider unlovely. And today it may be there's someone here who is close to giving up on God. Close to quitting on him, his assignment for them. You've stopped listening to the word of God. You've stopped listening to that still small voice that he calls to you. But friend, we must learn from this decision that Jonah makes. We must learn from it and stay committed to the Lord. Ask God to help us to be the people that he's called us to be. We must make a decision daily to be in God's presence, daily to commune with him, daily to hear from God's word and let him speak to our hearts, to stay committed to that call and that assignment that God has given to us. Because if not, we're going to make a decision much like Jonah. Not only do we see his decision, but notice finally we see his direction. His direction. Verse 3, "But Jonah rose up to flee unto Tarshish from the presence of the Lord and went down to Joppa. And he found a ship going to Tarshish, so he paid the fare thereof and went down into it to go with him unto Tarshish from the presence of the Lord." Notice verse number 5. "Then the mariners were afraid and cried every man unto his God and cast forth the wares that were in the ship into the sea to lighten it of them. But Jonah was gone down into the sides of the ship, and he lay and was fast asleep. We see that the direction that Jonah went when he chose to abandon God's assignment, when he made this decision, we see his direction was where it was down. It was down. It was further and further and further away from God. As Jonah made this decision, we can see his direction was down. I can just picture in my mind's eye Jonah as he comes to Joppa on the coast near the Red Sea. The Mediterranean Sea. As he comes and he's going there on the docks and he's walking back and forth and he's talking to these mariners trying to find someone who's got a ship and where they're going. I'm going to Athens or I'm going here, I'm going there. And none of these are far enough away. And he finds one that says, I'm going to Tarshish. At that time, Tarshish was the farthest point away, really, westward of the known world. And Jonah says, you know what? I'll take that one. And look again at the verse number 3. And it says, so he paid the fare thereof. Jonah paid the price for his passage on this ship to try to get away from God's will. But he has no clue what it's going to actually cost him. He may have paid a price to get on a boat, but folks, it's going to cost him so much more than what he paid here. And listen, if he just would have paid the price to follow God, he would have saved himself a lot of pain, a lot of heartache. We could look at this passage and say, well, Jonah got a boat. He still found a passage. Look, God provided him a ship. It was God's will for him to get away from there. He provided him that place that he was supposed to go. But folks, we have to be very careful letting circumstances determine God's will for your life. Just because there's an opportunity doesn't mean it's what God wants for you. Just because there is a chance doesn't mean it's the way you're supposed to go. And I read this as I was studying for it. The ready way is not always the right way. Do you not think that Satan will use people and places, positions? He'll use those things to lead you away from God? Christian, please be careful in thinking that convenience means that it's God's will for you. Young person, please be careful thinking that convenience means it's God's will for you. That's not always true. And just because Jonah found a passage doesn't mean that that was what God wanted him to do. And we know that clearly. But Jonah paid the fare for his passage. He had no clue what it would really cost him. Down to Joppa. Down into the ship. And later on, down into the fish's belly. The direction of Jonah's abandonment was down. And guess what? When we give up on God, the only direction that we can actually go is down. But again, let's not be so hard on Jonah today. Because many of us are just like Jonah. God has given us an assignment. And we're tired of that assignment. We're tired of serving that ministry over and over and over again, week in and week out. We're tired of the day in and the day out, the constant grind. We're tired of the things that just seem to be over and over and over again. But could it be that that exact thing is what God is calling you to do? Could it be that place that you're at, that workplace, is exactly where God wants you to be? Could it be that those people in your life, those co-workers, that family, whatever it is exactly the people that God wants you to be a witness and a light to? Could it be that God's assignment for you today is exactly where you're supposed to be? And folks, be very, very careful today that you don't abandon the assignment that God has given for you. That you don't tell that still small voice of God's Holy Spirit to be quiet. That you don't make the same decision that Jonah did to try to flee from the presence of the Lord. Because I can tell you, the direction away from God is always down. And if you quit on God today, the only direction you have to go is down. And friend, today I want to warn you, as I warn myself, don't give up on God. Don't quit on Him. It's always too soon to quit on the Lord. It's always too soon to give up on Him. God today has an assignment for you. Don't abandon it. Don't run away from it. May we be wise and use God's word and the example of Jonah that we would understand. We would ask the Lord today to help us to make that commitment to not give up on God. Let's bow our heads for prayer. Where are you at this moment in your spiritual life? Are you on the edge of giving up on God? Maybe the trials, the tears, the temptations, whatever it may be, they're too much. Friend, don't run from God. Run to God. Run to the Lord today. God has an assignment for you. Don't abandon that assignment. Learn from this man, Jonah. Find your help in God. Ask him to help you commit to not to give up on him. Maybe you're here today and you don't know Christ as your personal Savior. Truth is that God loves all people. The other truth is that all men are sinners. You have broken God's law. You have done wrong. The good news is that God sent Jesus Christ to die on the cross for your sin, to take on that punishment and pay the penalty for your sin. He took it on himself. And today, as God speaks to your hearts, that Holy Spirit is working in you, you must personally ask Christ to be your Savior, to accept that gift of salvation that God has provided for you. And in just a moment, we're going to have an invitation. And that means that it's time for God's people to do business with him. If God has spoken to you, don't push off his Holy Spirit. Deal with whatever he's bringing to your mind. If you don't know Christ as your Savior and you would like to, if you'd like more help on that, you can come forward in this time. We'll take God's word and show you. You can have your sins forgiven and have a home in heaven. But in this invitation time, you do business with God. Father, I ask you to help us now. Lord, help your people. Get a hold of us this morning. Help us to understand the assignment you've given to us. Lord, help us to not abandon it. Lord, help us to be committed. Recommit us today to what you've given us to do. Well, thank you. In Christ, we do pray. Amen. Let's stand to our feet together. The piano's going to begin to play. We're going to sing a hymn of invitation. Again, this is the time for you to do business with God. These altars are open. You can come and pray. You can pray at your seat. Whatever it is, if you need help, you come forward. We'll have someone take God's word and counsel you and help you. Whatever God's spoken to you about today, don't push it off. As God speaks, you move and do business with him. Sit at this time, and our ushers are going to make their way forward to receive our offering. I want to say thank you so much for being here. If this is your first time with us at News, we're going to say thank you for joining us and worshiping with us today. If you would, on your way out, stop at our Welcome Center desk and fill out a Connect card to let us know it's your first time with us. We're going to say thank you in person to being here and for choosing to be with us and worship this morning. We're honored to have you. In just a moment, I'm going to ask Joshua Anderson to pray for our offering this morning to receive it. I just want to give you a quick update. You know, we've been receiving money for our Ukrainian friends there. And just to give you an update, we I challenged you. We were going to write a $3,000 check from the mission fund, and I challenged you to try to match that for a total of $6,000. And you went above and beyond that. You personally, as a church, gave $6,000, and with the $3,000, it'll be $9,000 given to our friends there in Ukraine. Praise the Lord for that. And they can certainly use it. Thankful for you and for your giving for that. I'm going to ask Joshua Anderson to pray and receive our offering this morning. This is Kyler Morrell, and he came to me last week and said he wanted to be baptized, and we talked for a little bit and made sure he understood baptism doesn't save us, it's just an outward expression of an inward change. In other words, he identifies us with the Lord Jesus, and Kyler is wanting to tell people today that he knows the Lord's his Savior. He's not ashamed of it, and we're thankful for that. Kyler, do you believe that Jesus Christ died on the cross for your sins?
Yes.
Have you accepted him as your personal Lord and Savior?
Yes.
All right. Go ahead and plug your nose. I baptize you, my brother, in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the blessed Holy Spirit. Be with Christ in baptism. Raised to walk in newness of life. Be careful.
Let me get just a few reminders before we're dismissed. Choir practice tonight at 4:30. 4:30 tonight. And then right after the services tonight, we'll begin our cornhole tournament. And this is a fundraiser for camp, help our young people go to camp. And so stick around. Even if you're not going to play cornhole, we'll have some refreshments in that you can purchase after the service. And we look forward to having a good time of fellowship tonight. And I think there's a couple, maybe one or two open spots if you want to play. To come, each team will be $20, but if you want to play tonight, we'll look forward to that. So plan on staying after the services. And then tomorrow night is our monthly men's meeting at 7 o'clock. And so men, let's come out and be over at the Fellowship Hall at 7 o'clock tomorrow evening for our men's Bible study. And then we have a church-wide work day coming up this Saturday. And we'll begin about 9 o'clock, close about noon. But if you can come and meet with us, we'll be inside, we'll be outside. We have a lot to do, kind of a little spring cleaning. If you can help us on Saturday at 9 o'clock, we'd certainly appreciate that. And then ladies retreat in the camp at Wilds, there at Brevard. If you want to sign up for that, if you have some questions, see Miss Allie afterward. She'll be back in the back and take questions about that. Also, the ladies' banquet that is coming up in May the 4th, We're looking forward to the Raverts being with us at that time, and Mrs. Ravert will be speaking for us, and that is $10 per seat, and 13 and up, 12 and down are free. And if you want to decorate a table, we'd certainly like you to do that, and see Miss Allie about that, getting a table and that type of thing. Also, we have Better Years coming up Tuesday, April the 23rd, a few weeks off for that, 11 o'clock. Any of our Better Years crowd, we certainly would like you to come if you have that Tuesday morning off. Meet with us. We have a great time. We have food. We have fellowship. And open up the Word of God for a little while. And we want you to come and be with us. Let's stand. We'll be dismissed this morning. We pray we'll see you tonight. Prayer meeting at 5:30. Meet over in the fellowship hall. Services are at 6. Please come back and be with us. Father, we love you. We thank you for the time we can spend together. We thank you for the challenge of your word. And certainly we thank the Lord for Kyla being baptized. And what a blessing it is to see these young people in obedience to you, to follow you in baptism. Father, be with us and guide us back here tonight, for we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. See you tonight, everyone. Bye-bye.